Oh, we are two niggas spoiling movements.
Yeah.
Brandon Collins.
That's me.
And Justin Brown for your moving needs. Medium popcorn.
Woo!
You haven't seen it, well, we're gonna spoil it.
Spoil it in your face.
That's your warning. So if you get pissed, it's all your fault.
Now I had the time of my life. No, I never felt this way before.
Yes, I
swear it's the truth. And I owe it all to you.
Cause I have the time of my life. And I owe it all to you.
Let's work. Yeah, shake your little white hips. You got no eyes.
I don't know this song.
Me neither.
Hey, everybody, this is your host, Brandon Collins.
Guys, and it's Justin Brown.
And we're here on another edition of Medium Popcorn Niggas Spoiling Movies.
Yes, we are.
And here's the thing. This movie got spoiled for me because I'd never seen it before.
Really?
I had never seen this movie.
Oh, wow.
I knew about the lifting and nobody puts baby in a corner. Mm-hmm. I never had any context on it.
Oh, wow.
And I kind of wish it stayed that way.
Oh, boy. Yeah, this one didn't age too well. Now, did it?
No.
This movie
has everything going on. It's like a Marvelous Miss Maisel Jewish summer experience mixed in with an abortion drama, mixed in with like a fucking Outsiders prequel. Because Patrick Swayze just looks like his Outsiders character.
Yeah. Patrick
How
Swayze,
old is he supposed to be? How old is Johnny supposed to be?
I don't know.
How old is... Because baby...
Baby looks like she's like 14. Johnny looks like he's 34.
Well, baby's about to... She's about to go into her senior year in high school, right?
No, she's...
Or she's about to go to college.
No, she's about to go to college.
So she's 17, maybe 18.
Yeah, 17 or 18. Yeah. But he looks like he is about like 42.
He looks old as fuck.
Yeah, he does. Patrick Swayze, you did not age well. But then again, once you saw him when he really aged, that's when you really knew how bad he aged. But then again, that was also the cancer. I feel bad talking about this, but hey, it's history.
Wikipedia says she's supposed to be 17, baby. Whose real name is Frances. Why does everyone call her baby? She's about to be a grown woman.
I think it's because her dad called her that.
This movie's supposed to be like a coming of age story, right?
Yeah, exactly.
But all it's about is like teenagers fucking and getting pregnant and then like getting abortions and trying to dance their way through their problems. This movie is full of nothing but broken people.
This movie is nothing is nothing but the fucking B2K movie, all revisited. Why am I forgetting the name of that
you
fucking movie?
Served.
Yeah, You Got Served. This is You Got Served, but at a summer camp.
Well, so you're saying Chris Stokes watched Dirty Dancing and was like, I got an idea. I can make this better.
Omarion! Omarion, bring me those kids who I've been fucking.
The thing is, the cat skills. All the time to be like a rich white person where you can just go away for a summer and just like do the same boring white shit all day.
So
they're doing merengue. That's not merengue.
Oh, no. That's
just like, baby, we had this dancer. She was a rockette. I'd be like, why the fuck is she up here?
Then? Yeah.
You know how far you have to fall to be a fucking dancer at a Jewish camp?
Well, maybe she did this during the summer. Because
those bitches train all year.
Yeah, you're right. I'm just trying.
I've literally been to a what is it, like the AOL Bill thing with the Rockettes, and they talk about how they train all year because they always have to do press events and all that stuff.
But
that job does not stop. They don't stop kicking up those legs for nobody.
Oh, I bet they kick up them legs.
You know the thing is, imagine like you're married to a Rockette, and then she's just like always kicking up her legs. But then you're like, come on, baby, show me a little something. She's like, no, I don't want to do it.
I'm just
like,
tired.
You're like, God damn it.
I got to watch them legs every day. And I can't do nothing with them.
Imagine a dude who did Lord of the Dance. Like, chicks were just like fucking wet over like the way he could move his legs and stuff. And then like they're like in bed together and they're like, just do the dance, Larry. He's like, I don't want to do the dance. Just do the dance.
It's like, God damn it. Oh, the end of this episode, Jim, just both of us standing there just going.
Just dancing for the video, yeah. By the way, folks, you should be checking out the YouTube page. We got all the videos and recorded episodes.
Actually, you should be going to the Patreon page because that's where the YouTube, that's where the videos are actually shown because they're unlisted.
Yeah, I should probably stop making some of them public.
Yeah.
I've been fucking up.
Yeah, you fucking jackass.
Yeah. You know what else is a jackass? Every white guy at this fucking camp.
They are horrible.
The Ivy League kids or the Ivy League college kids are the ones that are the waiters.
Yeah.
And they're all douchebags. The one kid, Robbie, gets this girl pregnant and then it's just like, nah, I'm not doing nothing.
While at the same time, fucking Jennifer Grey, well, baby's
trying to fuck his sister.
Yeah, that's right.
Just remember, she's like, I'm gonna sleep with him. And she's like, no, no, not Robbie.
And then he ends up fucking this old lady. You know, that old lady that was trying to get with Patrick Swayze.
She's a fucking him that night?
That's who she walked in on him with.
Ah.
Even though that lady has some,
I mean,
major guns.
There were some big Jewish titties in this movie.
Yeah, they were.
I'm not gonna lie. Did you know that there's like well, not did you know, but apparently a Jewish woman before like they get married, sometimes I guess they like to fetishize black men.
Did you not know this, Brandon?
I did not know that. I mean, like I hooked up with a few Jewish women back in Michigan, but I didn't know that was like a thing. Like before they lock it down, they like go and get to pound them with the brown.
Yeah, yeah, lots of Jewish girls are into the blacks.
Okay,
yeah.
You know the thing is, it's just like yeah.
What?
I don't know what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, you just it's like I'm gonna make this point, and it's like nah, there's nothing behind it.
Yeah, no, no, no.
Just wanted just to say this.
It's empty calories, baby. Well, I just wrote down, when we see Patrick Swayze, he comes in with his black leather jacket and his sunglasses, his comeback hair, and I'm like, why does Patrick Swayze always have to play characters that go against the grain? Why can't this nigga just be on his P's and Q's and not cause a ruckus?
Because he's a cooler brand.
He's like going on, he's like, you little college boy, get out of my way. Why go dance with these old women?
No, he said, you take the ones that are just on your plate, I'll take the hard ones, some shit like that.
Yeah, yeah.
Whatever's put on your plate, I'll take the hard ones, something like that.
I mean, the way they talk about women in this movie is atrocious.
Like, but this is the 60s.
Like, the director of, like, the Catskills camp, he's telling all the servers, he's like, make the women feel wanted, even the dogs. I was like, Jesus Christ.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I wrote down, and this is before we even got to the Dirty Dancing scene when all the campers, all the counselors and stuff are grinding. I was like, oh, this is just like a world where everyone's just fucking behind the scenes.
But at the same time.
And probably cheating on each other.
But at the same time, that's exactly what camp counselors and like things like that, that's all they do.
I never actually went to a real camp.
Well, I random little tidbit. So this was written about like a camp that this the writer, yeah, she actually went to when she was a kid. She go up to a resort in the Catskills, mm-hmm, whatever. So it's about her time up there. The resort that she's actually talking about, years later, many years later, I actually went to football camp.
Oh, okay.
At that fucking. At that actual camp that this, the Dirty Dancing is based on. And I remember, so they had people who worked in the kitchen and stayed there. Yeah. And it was still kind of like this.
Yeah.
We actually met some really, really hot fucking Eastern European girls who lived up there. We were hanging out with them. And we basically completely got cock blocked by the rest of our football team because the black guys, you know, ended up meeting these girls, so we're hanging out with them. And then it's like, and then they all just start. That's the one thing. You go to Catholic school,
which
is white dudes. If you start getting some play, they're just like, we need to get over there and see what's going on.
Yeah.
And they just
can't let these darkies, desecrate our pure white angels.
These girls were like really hot.
Well, I was going to also say,
and you're much older than us.
I was going to say, so also some of them angels, they like to get naughty.
Mm-hmm.
Y'all don't even know.
They want to dip down into the darkness, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, they like to. They like to see what's going down.
They want
to
get them white dresses a little dirty. They want to make their white dresses a little cream colored, if you know what I mean.
She got hungry eyes on my big dick.
Yeah.
Hungry eyes watching you.
What?
I was just trying to do private eyes by how adults are the biggest.
But this song, this movie literally has a song called Hungry Eyes.
I couldn't remember the song. Hungry
it's
Eyes.
Hungry Eyes.
I can play it right now.
I look into it and I realize you got hungry eyes.
Look, spaghetti on. This is my
Why would
space.
You play this scene?
This is your damn space.
We're just talking. This is a great song.
You gotta hold the fray. Again. Fray.
Because I want to play the song, but also emphasize how psycho John is.
He was not a nice man to her.
I have a theory.
Now I've got you in my sights. With these hungry eyes. One look in your head, I can't disguise. I've got
this is the first time in a long time, like... This is the first time in a long time in a movie where I'm like, both of the actresses have beautiful faces. Have nothing to work with down there.
I mean, this was also the 80s.
Yeah, but it was like, this is the pinnacle of what beauty was to Hollywood, which is crazy to me. Because it's so skinny and like, just nothing, nothing fun. Nothing fun to work with.
But then again, at the same time, again, they're playing next to small men. So it's just like, if they're
it's
too
supposed
robust.
To be 1963.
Well, yes. But if they're too robust, they're going to take away from, you know, what makes this man look like a man.
Well, okay, so let's talk about Johnny. Johnny is not a nice guy, like you said. He is incredibly rude to Baby the whole movie. When she's saving his friend, who's, mind you, should have gotten fired because she disappeared. She didn't show up for her dance gig. Mm-hmm. And then is crying in the kitchen. When Baby finds out that she's pregnant, she immediately goes to her dad, borrows $250 in 1963.
Yeah, that's a lot of money.
From her doctor dad, without giving him full context, so she can get a backdoor abortion.
Yeah.
Which she didn't know it was a backdoor abortion, but obviously.
Yeah, but I don't think, the other kid didn't know it was a backdoor abortion.
You know what, but it was like, Johnny's still mean to her. He's like, you think you just solve all your problems, blah, blah, blah.
You just run to daddy? I'm like somebody had to, because she would have died.
Nigga, what are you doing?
Yeah,
what are you doing? You're over here dancing a merengue with the same. You're dancing with the dancer. You're not even entertaining the clients.
Yeah,
the director has to be like, stop dancing with this sexy blonde bitch because that's not the clientele. You're just showboating. John, it's all about Johnny. Even the last dance, even the final scene in this movie, he stops the talent show and says, "Now I'm sorry to interrupt y'all, but y'all know I always do the last dance at the summer camp show, baby." And he just dances with her. Then he leaves her on stage and gets the rest of the counselors and starts dancing a la fucking Thriller from Michael Jackson. And it's just all about him. She's just like, ha, Johnny, I'm like, this bitch has Stockholm Syndrome.
And then she jumps down and then she runs and then she does a thing. And then his dad's just like, I know it wasn't you. And I admit I'm wrong. I'll say what I'm wrong and
R.I.P.
I'm wrong.
R.I.P. Jerry Auerbach, right?
Yeah. Way. You know what? I got to say, though, if there's anybody who fit the role of the dad, of like a 60s dad in, you know, in a movie, he really like exemplified it. Like to the T. Like to
what was
the
it like
T.
having a dad in the 60s?
Well, my dad was alive in the 60s. I imagine that your mom was alive in the 60s.
65, she was born.
Yeah, so, I mean, you tell me, Brandon.
I was just trying to throw you on the...
Yeah, I know. No, it didn't work. But...
You can't just yes and my shit.
Nope. Shut your shit down, nigga. But like he just like he really played like that kind of wholesome kind of guy. I don't know. It was
He's
just
a terrible dad,
huh?
The parents are terrible in this movie. They don't know anything that Baby does the whole summer. Baby disappears all day. She's not doing any of the community events. So where the fuck is she?
Oh, they should. She's doing an event.
I mean,
all right.
She's doing. She is pounding Johnny all summer. Baby wants a baby.
Well, it seems like a lot of people wanted babies in this.
Yeah, because when they go to the behind the scenes with the one counselor, as he's carrying a bunch of watermelons. And has
I don't
baby,
know why he's carrying watermelons to this place.
That was crazy.
It's like there's only one black dude in there.
No, there was quite a few, actually. There was quite a few black extras. Nah, I'm surprised.
Yeah.
There's at least five.
Yeah. I'm surprised that they were allowed to go to this camp. They must have been working way back in the kitchen.
I feel in a past life, those three black male extras were me, you, and Jordan Carlos. Like, we've been reincarnated, but like our past selves were. Oh God, I was tempted to wear my water. But yeah, they're all like fucking humping and stuff, and I was like, oh yeah, all these young people are fucking and like getting pregnant.
And I gotta say, they are doing it all fucking wrong. They are so off fucking rhythm.
The tight hips and like the weird rolls of the. It's like it's all like a that fucking movie with John Travolta, the sequel to Saturday Night Fever. Staying Alive, it's all like those aerobics classes.
Yeah.
But just like they're out like and about and that's how people dance like in
Dude,
general.
When Johnny and the blonde come running in and then they start dancing and they're grinding and she keeps on lifting up her leg, I'm just like, what the fuck are they doing? She looks like she's just having a goddamn seizure on the floor.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That whole like
she had poo face the whole time.
Well, dude, I wrote down, it's just like, for one, this is bad white people dancing at its finest.
Yeah, but this is like probably what made it such a popular hit, because white people were like, this is us.
You're right.
That's why you didn't have any black people dancing, to show them up.
Yeah.
This is pure like white
I mean, the one fucking black extra that they showed quite a few times, in those dancing scene. I mean, he kind of looked like dude from Designing Woman. He had the glasses on and everything. Oh, but, like, he should have been out there fucking, you know, showing these motherfuckers what it's about.
Why? Because he's black?
Huh? Yeah.
You know not all black people have rhythm, right?
Huh? Not all of us do, but, I mean...
Like, I can dance. I can dance, but I have trouble finding the beat.
Dude, amongst them, true. For what we were seeing.
Oh yeah, like for this crew, man, I could have had a dance off with Johnny and taken all his pussy.
They would have loved you. They would have been like, oh, look at nigger Brandon.
I mean,
look at nigger Brandon. Look at him move, dance monkey dance.
I mean, that's what they did with the gentleman who's doing the Spanish band.
Oh, the fucking old Tito, fucking Bojangles?
Tito Merengue or whatever his name was. He was doing the slowest tap dance of all time. It's so slow that old Jewish fat director can keep up with him.
Yeah.
I'm like, dude, you're about to die at the Catskills.
Well, I mean, looking pretty like sure he died.
Scatman Crothers.
I don't know, man. He's straight up Bojangles. He showed Mojangles.
Crazy.
I'm just surprised that he didn't have a fucking watermelon under one arm and just fucking with a top hat and a cane. Because he was there. He was right fucking there. But again, this is the 60s, so, you know, you got to mind the times. And then it is also weird that fucking Newman was in this movie.
Yeah, yeah.
Newman from fucking Seinfeld.
Yeah, Wayne Knight. I always call him Nedry from Jurassic Park.
Oh, which is funny because I actually met him in L.A.
Oh, yeah?
I met him in L.A. at an auto show.
Oh, damn. We should have got his number. We should have got him on the phone. We should have got him and we could talk about Jurassic Park.
I'm pretty sure he wouldn't want to do that.
Why
but,
not?
But also, fuck, I know the guy. He played Jimmy James in News Radio.
Oh, okay.
That dude, him and Newman, they come every single year. They always walk around.
Yeah, maybe
together.
He won't do the podcast and keep calling him Newman.
Well, that's another reason I wouldn't say anything to him. But I was talking to him about some vehicles. They were really nice. They were really nice. Yeah, it's just throwing it.
That's the story.
Yeah, that's the story. They were really nice.
All right, Chris Lambert.
you know what? Stop throwing stones just because you never had an opportunity to meet anybody. Okay?
I met a lot of people.
Who?
I met Harrison Ford.
When?
My first weekend in New York.
Did?
Yeah.
You did?
Met him at Calista Plucker.
What happened?
I just said, hey, Mr. Ford, I'm a huge fan. And he shook his hand.
Did
I
you?
Said, and you too, Ms. Flockhart. Because she was there. I was like, I acknowledge you too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Lies. Anyhow, so. I don't know, dude. Anytime they dance, it was just like they're doing way too much.
Doing way too much. This movie was doing way too much. We had a weird botched abortion scene.
Yeah.
Where they're like, he had a dirty knife in a folding bed. I was like, ew.
And you let him touch you with that?
She's like, I heard the screams in the other room. I try to get there in time. I'm like, my balls are hurting right now thinking about this.
So I don't even want to know.
I don't want to speculate. All I know is that that scene could have been way bloodier. The fact that Jerry Arbuck, baby goes through the cabin, gets her daddy, who comes with his little briefcase, the briefcase that all doctors had back then,
yeah,
with the little fucking morphine and shit. He just gives her a few shots, and then it's just
hey, like, he's just stone cold. Like, he's a stone cold killer. He's just like, everybody get out of the way. So what happened here? You had an abortion? Okay. Who is, who's taking, who does this young lady belong to? He's like, I'm the one who's supposed to look after her.
Yeah, Patrick
Swayze.
He looks
at her, he's like, all right, everybody, get out of the way.
Yeah, Patrick Swayze's like, I'm the one who's supposed to care for her. I'm like, oh, God. Why? She's not your sister.
Yeah, but I guess he just.
He's like, we're from the rough side of the tracks. I'm like, Johnny, you literally are trying to get a car to drive into town for a dance competition. And how'd you get into that car? You broke the window.
No, that was his own car. He locked the keys inside.
I know, that's
inside.
What I'm saying. He broke his own car.
Yeah.
He's out of fucking control. Johnny is a psychopath.
No, Johnny's.
He's probably one of the least likable protagonists I've seen in a long time.
Yeah. Because he's a prick to her. All right, so this girl can get an abortion that almost killed her, which also makes you think it's just like.
His friend Penny, played by Cynthia Rhodes.
Dude.
What else was she in?
Back.
Oh, God, she was in Staying Alive. Of course she was.
Fuck.
We got to do that movie eventually.
No, we don't.
We got to do Saturday Night Fever and Staying
Alive.
Please,
no. What the fuck was I trying to say? So, this was 1963. Obviously, abortion was very much illegal in this country.
Yeah.
And these back alley abortions, they must have been fucking brutal. I mean, because, you know, obviously, you know, by the time, you know, we started learning about what an abortion is, you know, in the 90s and shit like that, we heard about, like, oh, the old hanger and stuff like that.
Ugh, my balls.
And, like, that's a real thing.
Yeah. Yeah, I know.
Like, that's, oh, my God. Oh.
Patrick Swayze wore a girdle to look younger and thinner.
Dude.
Yeah,
how old was he?
Abortion was still illegal in the U.S. And it remained illegal in New York State until 1970.
Yeah. Dude, I can't even just like even think about like the methods of aborting a baby back then. That's
dude,
just
we're still talking about this.
No, dude, like it's oh,
all right. Well,
all right.
Let's be happy that times are different.
Yes, very much so.
Medical care is available for bad dancers, good dancers, white people, black people, Spanish people, all the people.
Unless you came from certain places, you know, with enough brown people where they'd say you're an immigrant because they don't want to treat you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know what? This movie was just all over the place, man. Because, like, you know, She tries to go to Robbie and talk to him about the abortion, and he's just, like, passive, and he's like, I'm going to fuck your sister. And then the dad, at the end of the movie, tries to tip this nigga.
No,
because of the service.
No, he doesn't. He's going to give him a recommendation to a medical
school. Oh, I thought
that
was money.
No, he's giving her a recommendation to medical school.
Oh, okay. I thought, because, you know, at the end of the summer, they usually tip the waiters and stuff like that. It's like, you know, when you're on a cruise, you tip the waiter after, like, you know, a few nights of service.
Yeah. No, not at the cruise I went on when I was overseas. Absolutely not.
Why not? What
happened? Dude, well, I mean, it wasn't the waiter's fault, but, like, listen, I have nothing against people from China.
Hey, you know it's gonna be rough when you start off a sentence with that.
Until I'm locked on a ship with them, they have to be the worst tourists.
Oh yeah, they're out of control.
On the face of the fucking earth.
Asian people are out of control when it's come to like travel.
They were wild fucking animals. But at the same time, I never understood. It's like, why are we afraid?
You just talked about the way that people talk about immigrants. You just call Asian people wild animals.
No, well, dude, They came with water bottles, with big water bottles, and they were filling them up with free wine.
What were you on, a fucking carnival cruise?
No, we were on this fucking cruise that goes from fucking Finland to fucking Sweden. And it's only like a day cruise. And they were just out of control. You could not get past them. It was like, oh, you're in the way to the buffet? They almost knocked us over with the stroller. We're trying to get to our seat. They refuse to move. They're just like, fuck you and fuck your baby. And then just sitting there eating with their fucking mouths open. Wear bubble jackets on. I don't know why. You're indoors. Why are you wearing a bubble jacket? But like, you know, I know people here, there's like, you know, we got to watch out for the Chinese. You got to watch out for the Chinese. And I'm just like, I don't get it. We've never really, you know, like historically, the United States has never had a problem with the Chinese. But then I saw them on that boat. And I saw the lengths that they would go to get the things that they want. And I realized, these niggas are a problem. We should be afraid. If a cruise is indicative of how they treat the rest of the world, we are in trouble. Everybody, bear arms, the Chinese are coming.
Oh, man, this episode took a lot of time. Holy shit.
Gosh.
Where
were we?
Can we talk about how Johnny gets... he gets framed for stealing a wallet.
Yeah, well, no, for a couple of wallets.
He gets framed for stealing wallets by the Jewish wife that wants to fuck him, but that she sees him.
Wait,
with
that's
baby.
Who framed him?
Yeah, because she works with. She tells the counselor, the director, that he likes the Johnny might have stolen her husband's wallet.
And then we
remember that night that she's trying to court him and get him to sleep with her. She sees him with baby.
Yeah.
Which, by the way, how did they not know until the last day, the last few days that they were hooking up? They were, not discreet at all.
Yeah, and they were just, inseparable.
Yeah, he was, pounding her out, all day, every day. Mm-hmm. If he wasn't dancing, he was pounding her out.
Yeah. Yeah, once she gave that monologue, just like, I don't know where I'd be if I wasn't with you. I'm like, bitch, we only been knowing each other for the last 2 weeks.
I have some of that scene.
Can I come in?
I don't know, I hate to watch this whole thing.
Yeah, I guess it's not a great room. You probably got a great room.
No, it's a great room.
No, it's not.
Mm-hmm. That's the sound of a woman who really wants to dick tonight.
Can I just point out that there's not much difference between Patrick Swayze's place here and in a roadhouse? It's very bare bones in the barn.
Yeah, and he's probably not wearing any drawers under this.
Fucking commando.
No, leave it on. I'm sorry about the way my father treated you.
Why?
Oh,
he's a dick.
Your father was great. I mean, he was great. The way he took care of Penny.
Yes, but I mean the way he was with you. It's really me it has to do with. Johnny, I came here because my father...
You know, the way he saved her, I mean, I could never do anything like that. That was something that... I mean, the reason people treat me like I'm nothing is because I'm nothing.
That's not true. You're everything.
You don't understand the way it is. I mean, for somebody like me, last month I'm eating juju bees to keep alive. This month women are stuffing diamonds in my pockets. I'm balancing on shit, and as quick as that, I could be down there again.
No, it's not the
pockets?
Way it is.
They stuck some diamonds in this nigga's pockets? Yo, what kind of fucking half-wit dick does he have? Listen, I need to go back to the 60s and paint my white and get one of these camps. Make some money, make a little change.
Dude, Johnny is so lost, and he needs so much validation. When they're doing that last dance, and the way he's just so self-satisfied by the performance that he's giving, when he gets the whole crew together and he's dancing and stuff, I'm like, Johnny is dancing like this is like his big Hollywood moment. I'm like, nigga, you dance at the Catskills. No one sees this. No one knows about this. He's 1,000% insane. Johnny, here's the thing I wrote down. I said Johnny is one bad spin away from a pain pill addiction and suck a dick at Hell's Kitchen. He is not going to, his story is not going to end well.
Does Johnny also realize that he recently just lost his job? Nigga, this is your last hurrah. You remember how you were just earlier like, talking in this movie about how...
They gave me my bonus at least.
No, and they're taking your bonus too. But it's like you realize how, you know, you were just talking about how, like you're going to go, you know, you could, you know, one day you're eating juju bees to stay alive, and next thing these women are stuffing diamonds in your pocket. Welcome back to juju bees. It's over, Johnny. You better go right back to your daddy and get back on that goddamn paint truck because that's what you were going to do because you could get in the painter's union.
Jesus Christ. Johnny was so... You know what the thing is? You didn't even, like, I didn't even feel bad for Johnny because he's such an asshole.
Yo, she's... I don't think we got through this earlier, but she literally took the spot of his like best friend.
Yeah, to do whatever. The competition so he doesn't lose money.
So they both don't lose money. Yes. So she can go get an illegal abortion, which almost killed her.
She spends her whole summer learning dance.
And then also on top of that, she got the money from her fucking family. She's the one provided. She's literally saving the day. And he's treating her like shit. It's like, nigga, I'm doing this all for y'all.
Yeah.
Especially for you.
And on top of that, she's like, no, you're everything. You're great. I'm like, the chick who wrote the screenplay is all kinds of fucked up.
Oh, yeah.
I don't want to know how that turned out.
The 60s were a motherfucker.
Eleanor Bergstein. This is nuts.
Is she still around? Has she gone into glory? Is she going on to glory? She was born in 1938, so she's up there. She's up there. Let me tell you.
She's like, back in my day, a woman would be grateful if a man didn't slap her after tea time at 3. You're like, what?
Dude,
the shit that like we used to say was like acceptable for a woman to deal with from men, this guy, it's Stockholm syndrome.
Yeah,
she literally is spending her whole summer with this dude who's like kind of like not held her hostage, but it's just like this is all about me, this is all about me, this is all about me.
And she's like, it's all about you. Well, you know what? This kind of reminds me of like the time that I've spent, like the few times I've went to LA, or the dozens of times I went to LA, and like I would see. Because there's so many beautiful women in LA, because obviously it's a hub for entertainment, things like that, that a lot of guys out there, they get this thing, it's just like, well, you're a dime a dozen. So it really doesn't matter if I treat you like shit. So they are like horrible, the women. And now, mind you, I'm not just saying this because like I'm a guy and I said, niggas on the East Coast treat bitches better, some shit like that. No, like I've worked with a lot of women in LA that's like, we like you New York guys because you guys are a hell of a lot nicer than guys out here. They are fucking pricks.
Absolutely.
And because of that, they basically lower their standards and lower their expectations. They deal with shit. Like one of my friends lived out there, lives out there, and the first time, like after she moved, I was, you know, hanging out at her place and she was seeing this guy and I met this dude. I'm just like, who the fuck is this guy? Yeah. Do you want me to punch this dude in the face? He's like, oh no, like we're kind of seeing shit. Like, you're seeing that guy? It's like that's what's up out here. It's like, nah.
I mean, do you think that like subconsciously she was doing this to like just like get a rise out of her dad and like to push boundaries?
No, I think this is the first opportunity she had to do something outside of just school, stuff like that, and she feels alive.
It was so weird that we got like a voiceover at the beginning of the movie about like, you know, she was gonna go to the Peace Corps and all that stuff, and then never got another one.
Yeah,
like it was just like it just ended with them dancing, and I was just like, that's an abrupt ending.
Yeah, like what happens to Johnny?
It went from baby being all about baby to being all about Johnny, and I'm like, yo,
like, did Johnny die in a car accident on that in that night? Just going back down the fucking, I don't even know where he's going.
I want to finish this scene because I also want to read some of the YouTube comments below this scene.
Oh, yes.
It doesn't have to be that way.
I've never known anybody like you. You look at the world and you think you can make it better. Somebody's lost, you find him. Somebody's bleeding and
yeah,
you...
Yeah, go get my daddy. That's really brave, like you said.
That took a lot of guts to go to him. I mean, you are not scared of anything. I don't
know... I'm scared of everything. I'm scared of what I saw. I'm scared of what I did.
I just want to point out, in 1963, black people had to deal with this kind of bullshit and also whether or not niggas were going to come to their house at night and kill them.
Yeah.
Just saying.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. On top.
Who I am. And most of all, I'm scared of walking out of this room and never feeling the rest of my whole life the way I feel when I'm with you.
They have no chemistry. This makes no sense to me.
And then she's just like, I'm going to molest you now.
Dance with me.
No, I don't feel like it. Okay, we're done.
The first comment under this video is by a white woman named Victoria Thompson. That's where I'm posting your whole legal shit. She says, this is literally one of the most sensual and beautiful love scenes ever. They don't just go at each other and rip off clothes. Well, Patrick Swayze already has his shirt off, so that's already mute. They're close in emotion and take time to truly explore the other person. Victoria, first of all, the fact that you're commenting on YouTube about a love scene from 1980-something.
Which is supposed to be based in 1963.
And you posted this shit 3 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Just tells me everything I need to know about where your life is gone and the love in your life.
We coming at niggas on YouTube.
I mean, and one other person quoted, most of all, I'm scared of walking out of this room and never feeling it again in my whole life the way I feel when I'm with you. What better description of love could there ever be? Under the context of Baby and Giant's relationship, that should disturb the fuck out of you.
Yeah.
They've only known each other for a few weeks. And don't give me that Romeo and Juliet kind of bullshit. They had no chemistry. Jennifer Grey and Patrick Swayze have no chemistry in this movie.
They actually, one of the trivias, like, they actually did not like each other.
They didn't get along. Patrick Swayze had to convince Jennifer Grey to do this movie because they did not get along when they did Red Dawn together.
Mm.
And they still didn't really get along in this movie.
Yeah,
they had to show them footage of claim chemistry between the two of them for them to lighten up a little bit. But I didn't feel it. I got nothing from both of them.
Now, I know, like, one of the things with, like, the making of this film, they wanted, because of, I think, like, Flashdance. Dance. Fucking damn it.
See, y'all niggas be talking about me in that video for that.
Yeah, but it's not a name. It's just, like, I have a fucking mouth problem for a second. Because that movie was made with people who couldn't dance, so they had to get somebody else to stand in and dance for them. They actually wanted people who could actually dance. So that's why Patrick Swayze was cast in this movie. He was actually the first person cast in it. And then Jennifer Grey, they sought her out for the role because they knew that she had a dancing background. So they wanted all the people in this movie who were going to dance to actually be able to dance.
Got it.
So that's partly why this, you know, movie is what it is. But did they find the best actors who could dance?
I don't know. Swayze's all over the place in this movie. And then, like, you know, they have the scene where they drive off to go to the lake.
Mm.
And they're doing the balancing thing on the tree and shit. And fun fact, he actually injured himself doing that scene.
He had to get his fucking knee drained.
Yeah. Also, when they're
because that's a stunt, mind you.
When they're doing their rehearsals, and he looks annoyed of her, that's like a real annoyed face. They kept that. There's like rehearsal footage, and they kept that.
Really?
Yeah, like they genuinely did not get along in this movie.
I mean, just like you just can't do anything right.
She doesn't do the lifts during the first show and stuff. I was like, what is going on? And again, why did the parents not know where Baby is?
What kills me is when she doesn't do the lift, and then she just turns to him, and then he, like, turns around. She's going, she's doing the old thumb.
You know, Tatiana and I did, like, a dance together, and I couldn't do a lift because, I mean, she's a you know, bottom-heavy girl.
Wait, hold on. When you had to do a dance
together? We were in a dance concert in college together. This is before we started dating.
Okay, and you had to do a lift?
I had to try to lift her up, yeah. It was a nightmare. It just could not. Yeah, I don't have the upper body strength to do that.
Did Tatiana have to turn it around and lift you up?
With the first time we tried to do it, I definitely dropped her. That's what I'm saying. Like, she's seen me. She's seen the mess that I am. This isn't a surprise.
Tati is one of those women who had to lower her standards. Fuck you, man. You set yourself up, nigga.
God, this became a roast.
Dude, hold on. The dude who's obviously trying to fuck Jennifer Grey and his baby in this film, is the creepiest.
The nerdy dude? The nerdy Jewish guy? Yeah, who looks like... You watch The Simpsons, right?
Yes.
Remember that short Jewish dude that like tried to hook up with Marge?
Yeah.
Back in like the 80s, the flashbacks?
Yeah.
Just like him.
Dude, he has the creepiest fucking face.
Yeah, yeah.
And like, it's just like, oh, and this is baby. He's just like, he's like, hey, baby. He's like, well, baby, come on with me, doll. He actually literally says that. He literally says that. And then he goes, he's just like, yeah, I took the girl of one of these, the lifeguards the other day, and he literally said, what does he have that I don't have? And she turned around and said to him, he owns 3 buildings. And started laughing. I'm just like, who the fuck says that? And I remembered there are actually people who say things like that.
Yep. Also, I'm going to play this scene when she's like, how many women have you had or whatever.
Have some girl ever asked you that question?
Yes.
And it's always awkward.
Yep, and I never answer truthfully.
I don't even lie to him. Tell him I'm not telling you.
Have you had many women?
What?
Have you had many women?
Baby, come on.
Tell me, I want to know.
No, no.
No draws.
You gotta understand what it's like, baby. You come from the streets and suddenly you're up here and these women are throwing themselves at you and they smell so good. And they really take care of themselves. I mean, I never knew women could be like that, you know? And they're so rich, so goddamn rich, you think they must know about everything. And they're slipping the room keys in my hands 2 and 3 times a day, different women. And so here I think I'm scoring big, right? And for a while you think, hey, they wouldn't be doing this if they didn't care about me, right?
That's all right. I understand. You were just using them. That's all.
No.
He's like, no, they're still using me. They're using me.
But you see, everything's like a sob story with this guy.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, I'm alive. I love, blah, blah, blah.
I'm poor. I was poor. Do you understand what that's like, baby? I'm poor. I come from nothing, and I see these people, and they have something, and then I figure I maybe want some of that, so I let them fuck me. And guess what I end up after? Poor. I'm poor.
He's always poor.
That's basically his whole arc in this movie. I'm poor. That's all he fucking says. He just cries poor. He's like my fucking dad. He was like my fucking dad. He's like, nigga, I ain't got no money. I'm going to fix income. That's Patrick Swayze in this movie. It's absolutely absurd. And guys, all right, ladies, if you are listening to this podcast, please never, never, never ask a man, hey, how many girls you been with? And also, you know, if you're a guy listening to this podcast, never ask a woman, hey, how many guys have you been with? Because that is the biggest bitch move to make as a man, especially, because you shouldn't care. Whoever she's been with before you, that shit don't matter. Yeah. I mean, unless you're dating a girl who literally is a prostitute, because in that sense, nigga, you're going to have to try, try to find out if she got the apes.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
I mean, let's be real. You got fucking herpes just morphing into fucking shit. Who knows? But, like, you should never ask anybody that question.
Dolan, when he was playing Pinochle last night, he was in his jacket hanging on the back of his chair. He had it at 1:30, and when he checked again at 3:45, it was missing.
Fucking Law and Order.
Vivian thinks she remembers this dance kid, Johnny, walking by. So we ask him, do you have an alibi for last night? He says he was alone in his room reading.
There are no books in Johnny's room.
There's been a mistake. I know Johnny didn't do it.
There have been similar thefts at the Sheldrake, and it's happened here before. Three other wallets.
Well, I know he didn't do it.
Stay out of it, baby.
Wait, don't put those tables together. Come on.
Daddy, I need your help. I know Johnny didn't take Moe's wallet. I know.
Oh, how do you know?
I can't tell you. Just please trust me, Daddy.
I'm sorry, baby. I can't.
This Danish is pure protein.
Mr. Kellerman, look.
Pure protein?
Maybe
a
Johnny
Danish
didn't
nigga?
Do it. Anyone could have taken
it. Are you fat?
Maybe it was, it could have been that little old couple, the Schumachers. I saw her with a couple of wallets.
Sylvia and Sydney?
Baby, you don't go around accusing innocent people.
Yeah, but I saw them. I even saw them at the Sheldrake. Didn't you say something was stolen at the Sheldrake?
I got an eyewitness, and the kid has no alibi. Come on, Neil. You learn what it's like to fire an employee.
No, Mr. Kellerman, wait a minute. I know Johnny didn't take the wallet. I know he didn't take it because he was in his room all night. And the reason I know is because I was with him.
Now, she could have spared her dad that little tidbit.
Yeah.
She could have just walked away as they walked away.
Hey, can I talk to you for a second?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's all she had to do. If I was her dad, and you know, so the next scene, he's like sitting out, like looking out at the water. Yeah, he's just like, my my daughter is being pounded out by this motherfucker right under my nose.
And he's crying because he thinks that also he got that Patrick Swayze is the one that got that girl pregnant.
Yeah.
So she's like, she's a whore.
My daughter's a whore.
He's like, now I have to go back to the New York City and become a detective to protect future women like this.
Dun dun.
Yeah, it was just so weird. Then Patrick Swayze, of course, it's like, I'm out, baby. I'm out.
Yeah.
So even though I didn't steal the wallets, they still fired me anyway because I've been fucking you. And now I'm poor. So we know about the last scene and like the last dance and this iconic scene that, yeah, sure. It's like, you know. Whatever. I mean, white people love that shit like crazy. Jennifer Grey was on fucking Dancing with the Stars and she did that dance and everyone lost their shit.
I got to say, she looks good for her age. She's like 60.
She does. She does. I think
she looks really good.
Yeah. I was just like, you know what it is? I think she's actually really pretty, but like so skinny.
Well, I mean, yeah. I mean, but that was in back then and, you know. Luckily for fucking humanity, that's not what's in now. Yeah. Well, it's also because half the time you can't be like that anymore.
You can't body shame really skinny women though.
No, but I'm saying it's like you can't. You know, it's not realistic to be like that. I mean, especially with our food and things like that. People are just women are more curvy, and to try to put out an X. You know, an example of female beauty is like these fucking tiny women is unrealistic.
Yeah. I can't believe Time of My Life won an Oscar for Best Original Song.
I mean, it's a good song.
It is. It is catchy.
It is a good song.
I don't know any of the words, but yeah.
That Time of My Life.
Well, abortion rights activists have called this movie the gold standard for cinematic portrayals of abortion. Oh, boy.
Is the gold standard?
Yeah. I don't know, man. I mean, this movie was just out of control. Johnny was just out of control. Like, he was a terrible protagonist.
Yeah. Dude, he taught her how to dance like an abusive father.
And then how to fuck. Because she was a virgin.
Like an abusive father.
All right, so just a break down our rating system after that.
I mean, Brandon, you put it in my hand. I got to dunk that shit, nigga. I got to dunk it. All right,
break down our rating system.
All right, guys, you know how we do this. We rate movies with bags of popcorn, small, medium, large, and an XL for the exceptional. If a movie does not deserve any popcorn, we can throw it into the dog shit pile and pile all those dog shits on top of it. So, Brandon, we sat down and watched Dirty Dancing, Patrick Swayze, Jennifer Grey, 1987, 2 years before Roadhouse, before Patrick Swayze realized that dude with a goddamn feather hanging from here fucked guys like him in prison. What say you, sir?
Oh, my God. You know what's crazy? I was wondering who the friend that like took the girl to the abortion, who he reminded me of? He reminded me of that actor who told Johnny he used to fuck people like him in prison.
Maybe it was him.
Maybe. All right. This is getting small. I had never seen it before. I'm just glad it was like barely over an hour and a half. It was just like, I could see why it was a hit back in the 80s.
Yeah.
But now I'm just like, oh, this is just all kinds of boring. And also just again, the actors had no chemistry. So then the whole love story falls apart for me.
True.
Yeah. And it just, after that, like once I realized that and like couldn't buy into the love scene, I just like was just floating along until the last scene and like saw like some slightly amusing dancing and then it was over.
Yeah.
What about you, Justin?
I'm going to give this a pile of dog shit. I'm going to give this a pile of dog shit. Because, again, like you said, there was no chemistry. There's no chemistry. The story was blah. The acting was blah. Because if you have no chemistry, then who gives a fuck? Yeah. You know, like, every fucking guy in this movie, you know, beyond... Actually, I don't know if there's a really a redeemable male character in this movie other than fucking Bojangles.
Yeah, they're all dog pieces of shit.
Yeah, they're all kind of
shitty.
Including
the dad.
Yeah, so like, you know, that like this movie basically leans on that final dance scene, which is fun and nice, but it's not enough to hold this movie. Keep this movie afloat.
It didn't keep me wet at all.
Yeah. Yeah. So this is a pile of dog shit for me, man. It's forgettable. And after, you know, that last scene isn't, but the rest of the movie you forget. Watch this movie on YouTube.
Do you think Havana Nights might be
better? Oh no, it's probably terrible.
It's supposedly be a prequel, and Patrick Swayze does a cameo as a dancer, but it was like in 2000. Havana Nights came out in,
wasn't that with Antonio
Banderas? 2004. No, you're thinking about Take the Lead.
Oh,
let me try to find his cameo from Havana Nights so we can just see what this dude looks like.
Wait. How can this be a prequel to this fucking movie? But that makes zero fucking sense.
Why try to find that? Tell people how they can follow the show.
Guys, you can follow the show at Medium P Podcast on Twitter and Instagram. You can also leave us a voicemail at 347-508-0978. And guys, as you know, always leave comment, 5-star reviews. We love that shit. We love to hear from you.
Yes, we do.
You know, it helps Brandon, you know, keep himself nice and firm, and you know, keep his marriage going for at least another year.
Exactly.
So, you know, we need to get on that. And of course, if you're not already, if you haven't told a friend, Patreon.com/MediumPopcorn. Also, TeePublic.com/MediumPopcorn. You get yourself a little swag.
But Justin, you're forgetting the most important thing. Friday, August 30th. Live Medium Popcorn show. We're reviewing Con Air. Lower East Side of Manhattan. Come out. Ticket links are everywhere on our social media pages, all that stuff. MediumPopcorn.com is coming soon, so you'll be able to get it from there as well. Justin, how can people follow you?
Guys, you can follow me at Jay Brown Did It on Twitter and Instagram. Brandon.
You guys can follow me at American Collins, AmericanCollins.com, on all the social media platforms, all that stuff. I have found the Havana Nights clip where it's supposed to be actually a younger, because it's supposed to take place in the 1950s, a younger Patrick Swayze, even though this film was almost 20 years later. So here we go.
Hey.
Sorry.
No, stay. I'm almost done anyway. So what did you decide?
I entered the contest.
All right. Good for you. So how's it going?
Does not look younger.
Oh, great. It's going great.
Really?
No, it's not.
Yeah, this is weird.
God, I must have been crazy to think we could do this. It's in 2 weeks, and whenever he pushes, I pull, and I'm flowing, and I'm being free, and I'm making a circle, and I'm not an ironing board anymore, and it's still not working. And now he says, you're afraid.
Are you?
Okay, no. Hold on. Okay, this just...
He went to Cuba? Okay.
In 1952? Wait, in what?
It's 1958.
58.
So like 5 years before the first Dirty Dancing. He goes from Cuba to the Catskills.
When did Cuban Missile Crisis was a few years later after this. Because he wouldn't have been allowed to even go.
It's
to
on
Cuba.
The cusp. It takes place on the cusp of the Cuban Revolution.
Okay, all right. So let's just say this: how the fuck old is Patrick Swayze supposed to be in Dirty Dancing?
I don't know
how old. Literally,
exactly. That's what I've been saying. Like, this nigga's been low key 50 years old at this camp.
Now,
probably murdering women. Johnny's a psychopath.
Hold on, you realize that. In the movie, he said that he learned to dance from somebody who came to the camp, and they just wanted to teach people how to dance and, you know, whatever, and make you instructors. And he took up on, and then he like took a liking to it, and he just started dancing.
Oh, so he's a con man too. He's a liar.
So he basically just
murdered a bunch of people in Cuba. You can't trace me if you don't know I'm dancing,
dude. This whole thing is. Absolutely cuckoo bananas.
Well, the mystery of Johnny. The mystery.
Old fucking Johnny Utah.
I was going to say the mystery of Johnny Castle lives on. This movie.
Why would they do that in 2004, make a movie where Patrick Swayze is playing a younger version of himself? Make him older.
I don't know, man. But, folks, we hold you. We love you. We spin you, do a kickball change, and then we lift you in the air so we can touch your tingle berries and get the juices flowing because it's going to be a hell of a night. In fact, it's going to be a Havana night. Goodbye.
I hate you so much, Brandon. That's your warning. So if you get pissed, it's all your